I'm Tammy Kolda, an applied mathematician, and this is Unlocking LaTeX Graphics. On this YouTube channel, I'm providing a detailed how-to guide on using TikZ and PGF plots. These videos are based on my book, Unlocking LaTeX Graphics, as well as some bonus materials. Today, we're going to talk about loops in TikZ. These are incredibly powerful, but also can be incredibly frustrating. You can use loops in many different situations, even outside of a TikZ picture. The one place where you get into trouble is using them together with PGF plots. I'm not going to cover that today, but I will cover that in a future episode. This video assumes a bit of familiarity already with TikZ. If you don't have that, go back and watch some of the previous episodes linked in the show notes. We'll set up our document at overleaf.com. We'll hit new project, blank project. For the project name, we'll put in loops in TikZ. I'll go ahead and close this left-hand panel, expand the size of the PDF to 150%. Then we'll go ahead and get rid of this and put in our own front matter. The package TikZ is essential, of course. The packages parskip and full page are just to make things look nice, and the package hyperref is so that the author name links back to the YouTube channel. Today I'm going to talk about loops in TikZ. Let me start off by pasting the setup, which is just a 2x2 help grid inside a TikZ picture. And now we'll go ahead and add our first loop. So what is the structure of this loop? We're going to use a backslash for each as the beginning of the loop. That indicates that we're having a loop. Then we name our loop variable. So you can name it anything you want. It just has to start with a backslash. So I'm naming it backslash I. Then the keyword in. And then contained in curly braces are the values that the loop variable will iterate over for that loop. Now the contents of the loop in this case are a draw command. I don't have it in curly braces, but if I had more than one command I wanted the loop to execute, I'd have to put everything inside of curly braces. The loop variable slash I goes from 0 to 9. Notice that I've been able to use a dot, dot, dot here. TikZ can generally infer the loop pattern if you just give it a couple of pieces to work with. And then here I'm using the loop variable to indicate the lower left corner of each of my rectangles. And then I am drawing a new rectangle incrementing by 0.2 at each step of my loop. The foreach command can also be inline in a path statement. So let me do the exact same picture, but a slightly different way. So now I've put the foreach inside the path statement. Remember, slash draw is a shortcut for slash path with the option draw. So I have the foreach inside the path statement. The main difference is that it does not have a backslash. The other main difference is that the loop contents must be contained in curly braces. This is to separate them from the semicolon that ends the entire path statement. So in this case, it's the exact same thing. And the only thing that has changed is no backslash and then the addition of the curly braces. And I get the picture over here. And then I did change the color red just so you could tell the difference between the two. I generally don't use foreach statements inside of path statements. It gets a little confusing, but it is an option that's there for you. Another thing to know about TikZ loops is that loops can be nested. So let me show you an example with an outer and an inner loop. So here we have a TikZ picture. It has two loops. There's a foreach outer loop over X and a foreach inner loop over Y. For each XY pair, I go ahead and plot a circle at that XY coordinate. And then I also add a node abovehand that lists the XY coordinates. I'm using the style coord, which I've defined up here to be above whatever coordinate I specify. The text should be gray and the font should be footnote size. So the result we see over here. And we can easily adjust this. For example, if I change this to be dot, 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 comma, 4, now we make it bigger in the X direction. One really interesting thing about TikZ is beyond nested loops, you can also have two variables defined inside the same loop. So let me get some things set up here first. I'm going to first add a little segment of code that defines a circ node type that I'll use later on. It makes the node a circle, it draws the outside, fills the inside, sets the font, and sets the minimum size so that all the circles will end up being the same size. Now let me get some code going on with multiple variables. So here we draw a TikZ picture, and this is a multivariable loop. So I have my foreach statement, and then I have three variables, backslash LTR, backslash X, and backslash Y. These are separated by forward slashes. Likewise, the values that these triplet of variables take on are separated by commas, and then the individual values of the variables are separated by backslashes. Over here, I give the coordinate of A, I give the X and Y value, likewise for B, C, D, and E. and then each of those is drawn as a node at the specified location. I could format this in a different way. I could actually make the entire coordinate into a variable. The main problem here is that the coordinate would have a comma in it, and commas are also separating the loop values. So let's see how you should do that to make that work. So here's the same thing done a different way. And with loops and TikZ, there's always 10 different ways to do one single thing. But I want to use this as a way to show you how you can handle commas inside one of your values. And the way that you do that is I now have just two variables, LTR and coord. And because coordinate has a comma in it, I have to contain it inside curly braces. So that's the simple fix for that. Just remember to use your curly braces. And I end up with exactly the same thing here. Instead of specifying x, y explicitly, I just use slash coord, which takes on that x, y pair of values. There are some useful options for each statement. Let me go ahead and give you one of the most useful ones, which is the count option. So here I am using this option. It follows right after the for each statement in square brackets. And then I just say count equals, and then I give it the name of the macro that I want to save the count. Here I'm using backslash CNT. I'm looping over a set of letters going from Z down to S. I think it's really cool that TikZ can figure out how to count backwards using letters of all things. The contents of this loop are inside curly braces because I have two different statements, a node statement and a draw statement. And so in that case, curly braces are required so that we know how to group things. The count statement is used here in positioning the node. I am creating a node called LTR at every iteration, and basically it's just overwritten the next iteration. I use that reference to that node once, and then I overwrite it. In general, I actually don't recommend doing node references this way because it gets a little confusing. I like to put in slash CNT and use that counter as a way to keep my different node names straight. So we can just go ahead and make that fix and it gives us the same result. And I can also then later go back if I want to reference one of those nodes and use them. Another option that the foreach supports is deriving new variables from your loop variables. So let me show you an example segment of code that demonstrates this. So now we're going to define two variables using the PGF math macro settings. The first one will just be slash inc defined to be 45. So that's our increment for something we're going to be doing in our loop. And then we're going to set capital N to be 360 divided by that increment we just set. Now we have our for each loop here with an evaluate option. So our loop will go from 1 to big N. And then we're going to evaluate our loop variable to create a new variable slash ang, and we're going to make that to be the loop variable minus 1 times this increment of 45 degrees. And then we're going to draw an arrow from 0, 0 to a point at 1.5 out at that given angle. And then we're going to add a node at the end of that arrow to indicate what that anchor was. So let's see what the results of this compilation are. So we see here we have drawn all our arrows 0, 45, 90, and so on. I could, for example, change this loop very easily. Suppose I was like, oh, I'd rather have every 30 degrees I'd like to show the arrow. I can easily change that, and you'll see a change in the results. Now let's have a little bit of fun. So let me make a slightly artistic example here. I'm going to draw a basic house. So here's my artist rendering of a house. And then I just want to give you a sense of where is the 0, 0 coordinate of this house, because it might not be obvious. So here's the 0, 0 coordinate, which will help when I show you the other pieces that I draw. So I'm maybe a bit of a weirdo. I drew my house sort of at the bottom with just a little bit of the roof sticking over, like an iceberg sticking out of the water. Now I want to draw a chimney. So let me get rid of this. The way I'm going to draw a chimney is I'm going to kind of build it up. This sort of shows how I might do it if I were starting off to do this. So I'm going to draw one segment of the chimney to start. So here what I'm drawing is four little rectangles. So the rectangles are all with respect to 0, 0. I'm using the single plus, which is an operation that says make this whatever it is in reference to this first point. Do not update the point that's being referenced to. So all of these points are going to be with respect to 0, 0. If I were to change 0, 0, these would all shift accordingly. And so I draw this little block here of four bricks. Now let's go ahead and reuse this little chimney pattern that we've created over and over again using a loop. So I'm going to make four copies of this pattern, and I'm going to evaluate this loop variable I as a new variable y using 2 times I minus 1 just to shift things up. And so I have to replace this 0 with y here to use that loop variable. And now I've got a chimney that builds up. And so I could play around with that. Maybe I only want 3 repeats. Maybe I want more. We can do that. Now let's add some smoke. So let me go ahead and add another segment of code here. So I'll start off. I'll make my smoke come out of the top. What I've done here is I've drawn a set of 10 ellipses, and each of these ellipses are placed according to the loop variable I, which goes from 1 to 10. And then I also went ahead and I shifted everything up by 2 centimeters. So the 0, 0 was here to remember it. So I shifted everything up. And then I also made a little rotation on these ellipses. So they're sort of moving up and away. And then finally, let me add a little bit of randomness to exactly where that ellipse goes. That'll make it a little more interesting, a little more artistic. And then I could even add some randomness to the sizes of the ellipses. So let me kind of replace this little segment of code here. And now I've added randomness to the size of the X radius and to the size of the Y radius. So we get a little more randomness in our smoke. That was the little artistic moment for today. Finally, I'll get into another loop option that might be useful to you. There is a loop option called remember that can remember variables from the last iteration. So let me give you a demonstration of that. First, I'm going to just set up a loop with some stuff going on. So here we have a loop that has plotted a bunch of points. So I separately plotted the point 0, 0 with a circle and the 0, 0 labeled to the left. And then I went through all the other points and plotted them. And I had 2 loop variables, the actual coordinate, and then the location of where I wanted the coordinate to be plotted relative to the circle that we draw. So we draw a circle and then we add a node in the specified position. So for example, 1, 1 goes above, 2, -1 goes below, 3, 0 above, and 4, 0 to the right. Now, suppose I wanted to connect these points with arrows in the order that they go. Let me go ahead and post our code that has the remember option in it. So here I am using the remember equals coord. So I'm going to remember the coordinate as old coord in the subsequent iteration. And then there's this question of how do you set it the first time? And so the first time I'm saving it as 0, 0. Again, because I have a comma in my value, I'm encasing it always in curly braces. This is especially important inside the setting of the loop values. Then I'm going to go ahead and use that old coordinate that I just created. And now I can draw arrows from each coordinate to the next coordinate in the picture. If I had 0, 0 in my loop instead of outside here, well, that would be a lot more complicated. So I didn't do that. The one last thing I wanted to point out is that it's actually also possible to use foreach without TikZ pictures at all. So let me give you a little example bit of code here. I'm just going to make a foreach statement. I just do the loop variable LTR, and I'm going to go from A, B, all the way up to Z, and go ahead and print that out. The result of that is just A, B, C, D, all the way up to Z. So you can use foreach in other scenarios that you might find useful. I hope you enjoyed today's video. You should now know how to do loops in TikZ, inside TikZ pictures, or even outside as we just showed. There's a link to the Overleaf document that we created today in the show notes. And please click like or subscribe if you want more videos like this. Thanks for watching.